Good afternoon to you all. I hope you can hear all hear me. Please let me know if you cannot hear by typing in. All attendees should be able to type in. I can see if you can hear or you can't hear, so that I can adjust from this end. My name is Grace Choto. I work for AHDB Horticulture as the Knowledge Exchange Manager for Vegetables. This is our second microbials webinars in a series of three. The first webinar was last Friday. We covered risks of microbiological contamination during fruit and vegetable production and how growers can mitigate against the risk. An update on chlorate and perchlorate legislative changes was also given. Today, we'll look at commercial studies work that was done in Spain, where chlorine dioxide treated water and electrolyzed water were used for irrigation. Our speakers will focus on the impact that the irrigation had on chlorate and disinfection byproduct accumulation in outdoor and protected leafy salads. Our last webinar will be next Friday, 15 March, when we will cover the challenges of chlorate testing and why the Food and Biocides Industry Group are advocating for chlorate to be regulated under contaminants rather than plant protection product legislation. We have 43 listeners tuned in. We've muted all attendees to avoid picking up background noise. Our two speakers will give their presentations, after which I'll pose all submitted questions to them. Could all listeners please type in questions as they present? We welcome all feedback on these webinars. It is our second time running them, so if in the case of a glitch, please hold on, we will sort it. But we do appreciate all feedback on the webinars and on the work that we do on fresh produce safety. AHDB aims to help farmers and growers to produce safe, trusted food. Our first speaker today is Dr. Anna Allende. She spoke last week. Anna is a senior researcher on fresh produce safety at CBAS, CSIC, at the Spanish National Research Council. Anna is a well-known international lead on fresh produce safety. She has published multiple research articles on pre- and post-harvest technological interventions in microbial ecology and safety of fresh produce, with more than 17 years of scientific research, initiating, guiding, and managing applied research projects in the area of microbial safety in Spain, where she continues to work with companies such as Primaflor. Anna is also a member of the EFSA BioAS panel. She's speaking on the chlorine dioxide dosing of irrigation water impacts on the chlorate load in outdoor spinach. Anna, let me switch over to you. Okay, Anna, you should be able to hear me, Anna.
Hello, Grace. Thank you for this introduction. Can you see the screen now?
Yes, I can see the screen. You can go on. Thank you, Anna.
Okay, thank you very much, as I said, for this introduction. And as you just mentioned, I will try to give the conclusions and the results that we obtained in a couple of experiments that we were performing using chlorine dioxide as a water disinfection treatment. I would like just to refresh a little bit our minds of some of the information that Jim Monaghan was giving us last week regarding the risk factors related to the primary production. And we know what is compiled in the guidance produced by the European Commission, where the water has been highlighted as one of the major risk factors. So we have also made some perform some surveys, some baseline studies, and always water seems to have the highest prevalence for pathogens such as Salmonella or pathogenic E. coli, in this case, STEC. So this is the reason why many growers are more and more thinking about the use of water treatments, and there are several options. We know that the sodium hypochlorite is one of the most common water disinfection agents, but it's also true that chlorine dioxide has been also highlighted as a good alternative to chlorine. So what is chlorine dioxide and why growers consider this alternative as one of the potential options? Well, this is a gas and it has a very high water solubility. It's also known for being more than 10 times more soluble in water than chlorine and less corrosive. And probably one of the major characteristics is that is less impacted by the pH of the water. So we don't have to be monitoring and controlling the pH while using the chlorine dioxide. It's chlorinated organic compounds such as trihalomethanes and halogenic acids are not produced when we are using the chlorine dioxide, and this is a quite big advance compared to chlorine, because we are only dealing with the inorganic disinfection byproducts and not the organic disinfection byproducts like the trihalomethanes and halogenic acids. The way the chlorine dioxide works or oxidized is different than that used by the chlorine. So if hypochlorous acid is not formed from the reduction of chlorine dioxide. That means that by following a different pathway, the radicals and the compounds that form during the oxidation of the chlorine dioxide are also different. So in general, when chlorine dioxide is reduced in water, generating the chloride ion, and this is further reduced to form the chloride ion. And in most of the cases, the chloride doesn't stop there, so it goes until the formation of chlorates. And this is one of the main objectives of this talk, to determine which is the formation of the chlorates while we are using chlorine dioxide. Both of them, chlorine and chloride dioxide, are oxidizing agents. So they are electron receivers. And this is the way that they degrade the organic matter. So for those that are more willing to use chlorine dioxide, the reasons can be summarized in this diagram. So when we are using chlorine, it's true that the active forms of the chlorine are very dependent on the pH of the solution. So even applying a specific concentration of chlorine, we might be not having the most active substance or compounds, and it also reacts more with the organic matter. So in the case of the chlorine dioxide, apparently we might have more available concentration for the disinfection of the water, and this is probably one of the what they really try to convince the growers. There are many ways that we can produce chlorine dioxide. The most conventional and the most well known is the use of on-site generation devices. So we have the two compounds that are usually involved in this reaction, and then they are pumping and mixing to generate the chlorine dioxide. By doing this ways, in this way, it's assumed that we avoid the formation of the gas phase higher than 10%, which can be very dangerous because it's explosive. There are many, many different devices that generate, they can provide with the on-site generation of chlorine dioxide. And each one might be using different reactives and times or temperatures, and this will at the end have an impact on the composition of the final solution that we are generating. By using the on-site generators, it is assumed that usually the solution will contain about 4,000 ppm of chlorine dioxide. And as I mentioned, there are many different reactions that will lead to the formation. There are also many commercial brands that they are now producing different generators. One of the very well-known brands are Prominent, and we have been working with them a few years ago in order to determine the efficacy of the chlorine dioxide generated by this system. When we had the opportunity to visit a very intensive production area in California, in Salinas, we visited a on-site production plant that was treating the water that was in the water reservoir, that the one that was used to irrigate many hectares of spinach. And this type of generators are quite well known also in United States. In fact, for those areas that they are not so accessible or that they are changing from one canal to another as a source of irrigation, they are now using these mobile on-site generators that can be moved from one side of the production to another. And by doing this, they can keep using the same type of disinfection treatment and the same type of generator. So this is more and more common there, but it's true that in United States they are not so worried about the generation of disinfection by products by using these technologies. We have we also know that there are many companies that they are selling the stabilized solutions of chlorine dioxide. In this case, they manage to generate a stable solution that can be kept in a container, and this can be used for the treatment of water. It's based on our own results and also the some results obtaining from the literature, is been shown that these aqueous solutions of chlorine dioxide can have from 4,000 to up to 8,500 ppm of chlorine dioxide. We have been working a lot with one Spanish company that is Agri Clodos Technology, and the brand of the solution in this case is Agridis. But why are we talking so much about the different sources to generate the chlorine dioxide and why this is really relevant for the growers? Because depending on the type of system that you are using to generate the chlorine dioxide, the composition of the solution that we are going to use to treat the irrigation water will have a different composition. So, for instance, I've been taking this information from the website of this brand, the Pure Chloride Dioxide, and they were mentioning that when you are using a conventional on-site generator, similar to those that I have been showing you, you can generate 1,000 ppm of chlorine dioxide, but in 1 liter of this solution, you will also have 86 ppm of chlorates. They claim that by using the novel method that they have developed, in this case, the formation of chlorates has been reduced almost by 8. So this means that depending on the source of chlorine dioxide, we will be adding more or less chlorates when treating our irrigation water. The chlorates in this case are generated by the natural degradation of the solution. So also the time that this solution will be stored will have an impact on the concentration of chlorates that we might have in the aqueous solutions. We found also some information from is related to a stable solution of chloride dioxide, and in this case you can see that the numbers are different, and we can see that after 7 hours that the solution was generated, we were having up to 8,500 ppm of chlorine dioxide, and this was linked to more than 1,000 ppm ppms of chlorate. So this means that when we are adding this concentration or a dilute solution of this highly concentrated solution, we will be adding quite a high concentration of chlorate to our water. When the storage time goes on, so we can see that the concentration of chlorine dioxide is reduced, so it's degrading, but at the same time, the chlorate concentration is increasing over the time. We, using different solutions, we have been doing some tests with chlorine dioxide, with stable solutions of chlorine dioxide, and we were able to demonstrate that the length of the storage time will increase the concentration of chlorates that can be found in the AKEO solutions. But something that is also very relevant, the temperature of the storage, the temperature at which the product is stored is also very relevant. So if we compare the chlorates that can be found after 30 days, when we are storing the product at 5 degrees, is very high, but still around 6,000. While we are using 15 or 25 degrees, we are above 8,000. So that's also, there are many, many things to learn. First, for the manufacturers, because probably we should be asking them to have a very fresh chlorine dioxide solution to be used to treat our water, but also the temperature at which this solution is kept, it has to be controlled in order to reduce the degradation and the formation of chlorate. Just to make this a little bit more graphically and to illustrate how the temperature and also the length of the storage time is influencing the concentration of chlorates, I put the same data in a graph. But you can see that compared to day zero, the increase is almost double, and also the temperature will have a significant difference. The highest difference are between. Grace, can you hear me?
Yes, can I interrupt you a bit? We can't fall from this end. I can't see the slides changing. Your slides. I'm stuck on how chlorine dioxide is generated. Is that where you're on?
No. I'm already in the slide why the source of chlorine dioxide is relevant.
All right. Could speakers let me know if you can see, you're going on with, could listeners let me know if you are seeing different screens, please. It could be just a case for me.
But Grace, maybe you have to unmute someone to answer you.
No, I can't unmute, but they can type in. I can't unmute them because we've been set up, but they can type in. They can type in.
Okay, so we need to know because now I'm supposed to be in a slide number, let me tell you. I'm in slide number 13. When I'm talking about the concentration of chlorates in different solutions of chlorine dioxide.
Okay, well, it seems I had a colleague who's just come to tell me that everyone is fine. So it's probably just the organizer problem. So you can carry on. It's just been confirmed that speakers can hear. That's fine. Carry on, Anna.
Thank you, Grace. Thank you. Okay, we were looking at the graph where we can see the difference between the storage temperature and the days of storage. So after this overview of the chlorine dioxide, I would like to show you the results and conclusions that we obtained in two case studies that were performed in using chlorine dioxide as a water disinfection treatment. The case first, we wanted to do this case study in commercial fields. For that, we were very lucky because we were able to collaborate with Primaflor, and we were using commercial fields that they were using to produce spinach. In that study, we were treating the water that the Primafrol was using for irrigation. And I must say that the microbiological quality of this water was very good. So for us, in this study, it was very difficult to really determine the efficacy against the microorganisms, in particularly E. coli, that the treatment was having, because the levels of E. coli were very low for all the growing cycle in the irrigation water. And that's why we, apart from this study, that was the main study, we wanted to perform a second study in which we couldn't use the commercial facilities, because what we wanted was to use a very highly contaminated irrigation water to demonstrate that the treatment was able to be efficient to reduce the levels of E. coli. And this is why I will be presenting the two studies. But it's true that the main study will be the one performed under commercial conditions. So what we wanted in this study, so what we were using was, as I mentioned, a commercial field. Indeed, there were two commercial fields for Primafloor, and we were using the water that they had in a water reservoir that was used to irrigate these two fields. We were dividing the irrigation system in two. So one of them was using the water from the water reservoir without adding the chlorine dioxide. And then we have the part of the field that was irrigated with the treated irrigation water with chlorine dioxide. We were measuring the quality, the microbiological quality of the water, the spinach, but also we were measuring the concentration of chlorine dioxide and chlorates that were formed during the whole growing cycle in the water that was used, but also on the spinach that were growing in that field. For this study, as I mentioned, we were using commercial fields of about 0.5, 0.8 hectares. So the field was divided in two lots, one for the treated and one for the untreated. We were using a volume of irrigation water of about 25 cubic meters per hectare and per day. And the volume, the total volume that was used of chlorine dioxide for the whole growing cycle was between 150 to 200 liters. We did two repetitions, one that corresponded to a low, more winter time, which was January, between January and March, and a second cycle that was between March and May. I will be presenting the data obtained in the second repetition because it was better obtained. I'll just a little bit to show you how we implemented all the experimental design. So as I mentioned, we were using the irrigation system that the company was having in that field, and we were adding the chlorine dioxide solution according to the concentration that it was established necessary to have a residual concentration of chlorine dioxide of 0.25 ppm. The first thing that we wanted to evaluate was if the use of treated irrigation water had any detrimental effect on the quality or the aspect that the spinach had. And it's true that after the two experiments or the two studies, we didn't observe any detrimental effect on the quality of the crop. As I mentioned, our aim was to have a residual concentration of chlorine dioxide, which means that all the organic material can be consumed by the needed concentration of chlorine dioxide without exceeding the 0.25 ppm. Why we established the limit of 0.25 ppm is based on the literature, because this concentration has been established as a limit to not generate any detrimental effect on the crop. So during the whole growing cycle, we were able to maintain the concentration of chlorine dioxide below the 0.25. As I mentioned before, when we wanted to evaluate the antimicrobial activity of the solution applied in the water, because the microbiological quality of the control water was very good, it was difficult to have significant difference between the untreated and treated water. But in general, we always managed to reduce a little bit the concentration of E. coli in the water. When we wanted to look at the chlorates that were generated in the water, we see that the control was really almost zero for the irrigation water, while the irrigation water that has been treated with chlorine dioxide show concentrations below one, but about 0.46 milligrams per liter as an average of the chlorate. This is the 0.7 that is being allowed for drinking water. But what was more important for us was to determine if this, the application of this concentration of chlorates during the whole growing cycle could accumulate in the crop during the while it was growing. So in this case, we observed that the average chlorate concentration in the treated spinach, it was about 0.99 milligrams per kilogram. So almost 1 ppm of chlorates accumulated in the spinach that were produced under these conditions. We can have a look to the new requirements that has been recently published by the European Commission, which established that in babies in spinach, the maximum levels that will be acceptable is 0.15. That means that this product that has been grown under these conditions will be above the authorized limits. I would like now to present a little bit of the result obtained in the second case study. In this case, as I mentioned, we were using a very poor quality, microbiological quality of irrigation water. It was obtained from a secondary treatment from a wastewater treatment plant, and the levels of E. coli were, in most of the cases, above 4 logs of E. coli. We were using baby lettuce in this case, and we were using in a greenhouse because we wanted to have everything very controlled in order to not generate any problem of contamination. So as we did for the other study, we determine the efficacy to reduce the E. coli levels in the water and also in the product, but the focus was to see if the application of treated irrigation water using chlorine dioxide would lead to the accumulation of chlorates in the product. As we did in the other study, the first thing that we wanted to evaluate is if this treatment may cause any effect on the quality. And it's true that the growth of the lettuce was really affected, and you can see a really clear difference between the control and the treated. So we really observed that under these conditions, there was a detrimental effect. In this case, because the demand of chlorine dioxide of the irrigation water that we were using was very high, because it was with a lot of organic matter and a lot of microorganisms, we had to apply very high volumes of chlorine dioxide to have a residual concentration of this compound. In some cases, the concentration of organic matter in the water was also very variable, so this generated difficulties to maintain a very stable residual concentration during the whole growing cycle. And this is why you can see some peaks for the concentration and some of them above the what was established, the maximum limit, because it was the one recommended by the literature. In this case, because we were using poor quality water, we can see that, for instance, in this case, we almost managed for log reductions between the control and the treated irrigation water. Some days, these differences were not observed, but this was most due to the difficulties in the dosification of the compound than the that to think that the treatment was not efficient. But in most of the cases, as you can see, we can observe a really inactivation effect by using the chlorine dioxide. When looking at the chlorates that were accumulated in the water, we see that because we were using much more higher concentrations of chlorine dioxide to reduce the microbial concentration of the irrigation water, the accumulation of chlorate was also much higher in the water. So we could observe levels above 2 ppm in most of the evaluated days. But the question will be, as we were mentioning before, is this having an effect on the crop that is being irrigated with this treated water? And of course, the answer is yes. In fact, by using these conditions, the accumulation of chlorates in baby lettuce was really high, and in most of the cases, higher than 1 ppm. If we look at the maximum limits that has been suggested by the Commission, we see that this is really much higher than those that are authorized. So based on the results obtained in both of the case studies that we were performing here in the region of southeast of Spain, in both cases, in the open field, but also in the greenhouse, when we were using chlorine dioxide to treat the irrigation water, the accumulation of chlorates in the plant product led to concentrations above the authorized limits. Based on this, we can see that, of course, in those cases that the concentration of chlorine dioxide or the volume, the total volume of chlorine dioxide that was applied was higher, the accumulation was higher, that this is the case of the greenhouse. But based on the results, we can say that at this moment, by using the type of chlorine dioxide that we were using, we will not really recommend this disinfection treatment unless we are able to reduce the concentration of chlorates in the solutions of chlorine dioxide. And this is it. I'm open for any question if you have any. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anna. I thank you to all those who responded by saying you could actually see the slides. For some reason, I couldn't. It was stuck. So I'm hoping the recording will be fine because we're intending to circulate the link to the recording afterwards. Otherwise, we'll have to circulate the raw slides. I've got a few questions. On the program, we'd planned to go to Mabel, but I'm sure we can take a few questions now. Anna, are you going to stay on the line whilst Mabel presents?
I'm available until 3:30.
Okay.
That's okay,
Grace. So yes, that's okay. But in that case, we might as well answer the questions that I've got here. I've got a few. The first one is, if you generate the chlorine dioxide on site and pump it straight into the water without storage, what are the chlorate and perchlorate levels? Will we get residues on leafy salads?
Yeah, this is a very good question. But the problem is that depending on the generator that we are using and the reactives that we are using to generate the chlorine dioxide, the reaction will lead already to formation of chlorates from the very beginning. So what would I suggest is, of course, if we reduce the storage and if we maintain the conditions like the temperatures and to avoid the light and everything, we will stop the accumulation or the formation of chlorates in the chlorine dioxide solution. But I cannot tell that for sure you will not have chlorates from the very beginning, because it will depend on the reaction that is used by this generator to generate the chlorine dioxide. So I think that by the information that we are obtaining and with information that you will see in the next presentation with Mabel, one key learning is that we need to ask the manufacturers of the disinfection action solutions to provide us with the guarantee that the way that they are producing or the way that they are distributing avoids the generation of the disinfection byproducts, because otherwise we will be buying something that is half chlorine dioxide and half chlorates. So if we have already an on-site generator, I will do maybe a couple of analyses just to determine, just ready made, which are the concentration of chlorine dioxide and the chlorates. And then you can also evaluate after a few hours or few days, so you know which will be the dynamic of your own solution, because each one will depend on the reaction that the generator is using. As we say for many things, this is a case-by-case study, so we cannot make general conclusions for all the generators. But we were quite surprised that even just made, you might have some chlorates in the solution. So that's something that probably you have to check.
Okay. The second question is there any way of controlling the levels of chlorate by different methods of chlorine dioxide generation?
Yes, but I'm not an expert on the chemist of this reaction, right? So I'm more looking at the consequence of using one or another solution. But the literature that is available, we know that there are many ways to generate the chloride dioxide. So there must be some reactions that led to a lower accumulation of the chlorate, because they managed to generate a more pure solution of chlorine dioxide. But this is something that the manufacturers should provide the growers. So whenever someone is visiting you or trying to convince you to use one or another type of chlorine dioxide, I think that the certificate showing which is the concentration of the solution that you are generating, or which is the concentration or the composition of the solution that you are selling me directly in a container, they have to show you which is how stable is the solution and the real composition. Comparing different manufacturers, you will see probably large differences in the concentration of chlorates that they have.
Okay, the third one is there a possibility that more chlorates will be formed naturally in presence of chlorine ions in high light situation because of the potential presence for a high oxidative potential within the plant itself relative to dull, cool weather? So generally, would you expect more chlorate in sunlight than in coolness and dull weather?
Yes. As I mentioned, I'm not an expert, but I heard that the light, the solar light, is also moving the reaction to a quicker generation of chlorates, because there is another pathway that is activated. So the light is really a factor that will increase. Indeed, when we were doing the first study in open fields with the spinach, that was something that the manufacturer of the chlorine dioxide was suggesting, that maybe the light that was in the incidence of the light in the irrigation water after the application of chlorine dioxide could might be the one of the major reasons for having such a high concentration of chlorates. But then, well, we were trying to avoid the contact of the light in the second experiment when we were using the greenhouse, and we also observed high concentration. So I don't know up to what level the light, the solar radiation will have an impact, but it's described in the literature that it's a factor. I don't know if I have answered completely the question, Grace.
I don't know. It also says cool weather, so obviously relating to temperature, not only light.
Okay, yeah, well, We what we have done is evaluating during the storage time. So we were keeping the concentration at different temperatures, and this had an impact. While we are applying to the water treatment, I don't know. I cannot respond. Maybe Mabel can have some ideas later on, because she's much expert than me on this.
Okay. All right. So the person who's posed the question had said mainly light. So I think you have answered it. Thank you.
Thank
Anna,
you.
we've got one final question here, which says, under expected application conditions, would it be possible to suggest a harvest interval and how quickly will the level of chlorate degrade within the harvested crop?
Well, I also would like Mabel's opinion on this, but I don't think that once the chlorates are accumulated in the tissue, that they can degrade quickly. So I don't know, because if we are thinking about an interval between the harvest and the commercialization or the application of the irrigation water and the harvest, we probably are talking about a few days. And based on the data that I have now in my mind, I don't think in few days. But again, Mabel has done a lot of work on this, so I'm sure she will be able to answer this question also in the presentation she's going to present.
All right. Thank you very much, Anna. Those are the questions we had anyway. So let us move on now to our second speaker, who is Mabel. Mabel is speaking on irrigating with electrolyzed water impacts on disinfection byproducts accumulation in glasshouse grown baby leaf lettuce. So Mabel has a pharmacy degree and a PhD in biology. She's a full research professor at the Food Science and Technology Department at CSIC, CSIC Institute in Murcia in Spain, where Anna works. Her research activities are related to quality and safety of fresh produce, particularly leaf vegetables. She coordinates an expert group involved in fundamental and applied aspects of pre-harvest and post-harvest factors affecting quality and safety of fresh produce. One of her main tasks is the control of microbiological and chemical contamination during production, processing, and storage. She's the leader of national and international R&D projects with public organizations and public private companies. So this is Mabel. I'm handing over to her.
Thank you. Thank you, Grace. Thank you for this introduction. And I won't let me show you my screen now. Can you
Yes.
see my screen now?
Yes,
Okay.
I can see your screen. Thank you, Mabel.
Okay, thank you. So I will start with my presentation this afternoon. So good afternoon, everybody. And I will introduce the topic about irrigation with electrolyzed water and the impact on disinfection byproducts in a glasshouse grown baby leaf lettuce. So it is, as Anna mentioned, during the primary production, everybody knows that the role of water is of critical importance, particularly for the safety of fresh produce that has been the topic of and the interest over the years. We all know that the irrigation water is an important source for the contamination of fresh produce with human pathogenic microorganisms, particularly if the irrigation water is in contact with the fresh produce. And so there's the need for the disinfection of irrigation water. So this disinfection is a recommended mitigation strategy to reduce microbial contamination, and particularly to reduce the possibility of the potential contamination of fecal indicator bacteria such as E. coli. But it's not only to reduce human pathogenic microorganisms. The growers also use the disinfection of irrigation water as a mitigation strategy to reduce the plant pathogens. You can see in some intensive agriculture system, growers are now moving to use this disinfection of treatment of the irrigation water in order to reduce the use of pesticides. So this is what I will show you later in our study. Let me see if I can. Sorry, I cannot pass now. Wow. Grace. Grace? Grace, yeah. Can you hear me? Okay.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes. Now, so there's different disinfection technologies, as Anna mentioned before. Some those that are chlorine derivative solutions, as you know, are, for instance, the sodium hypochlorite, calcium hypochlorite, and chlorine gas. These three disinfection technologies are based on the production of hypochlorous acid, and there's a need of pH control. Particularly when you add sodium hypochlorite or calcium hypochlorite, you increase the pH of the water, so you need to add an acid to reduce the pH and have a higher concentration of hypochlorous acid. But in the case of electrochemical disinfection, you need only salt and water and electricity, and you form other oxidant species. This is the case of our study. We have the collaboration of this company that is a German company, and this is a equipment for electrolyzed water that, as you can see here, there's not only the production of hypochlorous acid, this system also, electrolyzed water also produce other oxidative species such as hypochlorite anion also, ozone, and hydrogen peroxide. So from the point of view of the microbial activity, electrolyzed water has some really high efficacy for the inactivation of many different microorganisms. There's also some ways of this technology, such as the sodium hydroxide. So, as other chlorine derivative technologies, electrolyzed water can lead to the presence of disinfection byproducts. I wanted to mention the two most important groups of disinfection byproducts. One is formed by the reaction with organic matter, that is not the case of irrigation water, is more on the process wash water. And these, the two main groups in these organic disinfection byproducts are the trihalomethanes and the haloacetic acids. Then we will cover some, but we will focus more on the inorganic disinfection byproducts that are formed during the manufacture and storage of the disinfection technology. And the main group is the chlorate. So what happened with the chlorates? I think we have a lot of data with the presence of chlorates in fresh produce, but linked to the use of chlorinated water for both, for product washing and also for the disinfection of a processing equipment. But the presence of the chlorates through the irrigation water, really, we don't know very much. We really don't know why this accumulation to the crop production. And so, because there's no much information, this was one of the main topics in our group, particularly the disinfection byproduct accumulation during primary production under commercial setting, and also the impact after processing, including, for instance, the washing steps and also the storage, during storage. As you know, most of the leafy vegetables used by the fresh cut industry are now cultivated in greenhouses. The reason is just because we can protect these baby leaves in particular from adverse weather conditions such as wind, rain, etc. And also because we can control the let's say more accepted conditions, as I told you, the plant pathogens, etc., many of the microbial contamination vectors, and we can protect the product from contamination, from microbial contamination. And you can see these huge greenhouses where we control the substrate, the water, etc. In particular, for baby lettuce, that are now used in bagged salads, the growers are trying to really increase the production. And one of the agricultural practices is the ability to harvest and then to regrow the after the first harvest, and with the same let's say with the same seed, they can harvest consecutively at least 2-3 times within a period of 10-30 days, and that's what we did in our study. So it's very important to understand if the chlorination or the disinfection treatment of the irrigation water can lead to the presence of disinfection byproducts, and because there's no any data. And the European Commission was asking for some data to regulate the maximum residue levels. As you know, Anna was mentioned, the last draft and for leafy vegetables is around 0.15 milligram per kilogram. That is higher than it was before, 0.01 milligram per kilogram. So there was a need to provide that data about if a chlorination or a disinfection of irrigation water was needed, and there was an accumulation. We needed to know this maximum residual level on the product. As you know, for the disinfection byproduct, there's no regulation at all for threonylamines and albacetic acids on the product. This table shows you the regulation for drinking water, both in the European community and also in the USA. So you can see here for total threonylamines, the most important one is chloroform, is 100 milligram micrograms per liter, and in a bit lower in the USA. And for albacetic, we don't have it in Europe, and there's 60 microgram per liter in the USA. So, but let me tell you, even I show you this regulation for drinking water, in irrigation water and in processed wash water, really threonylamines and albacetic acids are not relevant. Why? Because they are volatiles that are not really remaining on the tissue. The main problem is chlorate, okay? And as for chlorates, as you know, the proposed maximum residual limit that now the European Commission are having this draft is around 0.15 milligram for the leafy vegetables like baby lettuce, spinach, etc. So the aim of our study was to evaluate the use of electrolyzed water for the disinfection of irrigation water and the relevance on the accumulation of disinfection byproduct on the in the water and in the crop, and how some post-harvest practices like washing, packaging, and storage can impact the accumulation of this disinfection byproduct. So to study this work, for doing this work, we generated a concentrated solution of electrolyzed water. Then it was generated by some electrolytic cells. We use reverse osmosis water and salt as an ingredients, and we produce a concentrated solution of 1,500 milligram per liter of free chlorine. We this concentrated electrolyzed water solution was stored in a black plastic container in order to avoid, as we talk, the degradation and the higher production of chlorates, and then we pumped into the irrigation network, okay, as we need it. So this this water, the water used for irrigation was from a reservoir, and we mix this concentrated electrolyzed water in a, to obtain a free chlorine in the irrigation water of 5 mg/L. Okay, so with this irrigation water, we treat the it was pumped into the greenhouse, and we irrigate by a sprinkler irrigation. So we study in a huge greenhouse, but that time, this was 2 years ago, it had 3 hectares. Now Primaflor has 6 hectares in an automatic greenhouse. Is really impressive to see this huge area of greenhouse production of red baby lettuce. We studied 2 types of red baby lettuce. One was red oak leaf, and another was red patavia. And we cultivated under irrigation, as I told you, sprinkle irrigation. Then it was moved automatically above the trays, watering the plants of with approximately per day 50 cubic meters per hectare in the morning and also in the afternoon. So we harvest the baby lettuce, and from the same trays we grow again, and we harvest after the first harvest a second and a third harvest. So we did from the same plant 3 growing cycles in May, June, and July. This is really impressive because all the tables are automatically moved after the first harvest. There's a movement to one part of the greenhouse. The plant regrows again, and after approximately 30 days, 20, 30 days, you have a second harvest and then a third harvest. So it's very, very highly productive way. So after the baby lettuce were harvested, we transported to our lab that is just 1 hour far from Primaflor, and we did the processing simulating commercial conditions of washing, rinse, centrifuge, package in modified atmosphere, and we store the baby lettuce in darkness for at 7 degrees for 9 days. So these are the results. Let me show you in this table the physicochemical parameters of the untreated and treated water. And I show you here the two parameters that had significant differences between with the untreated water. You can see here the pH is lower when you treat it with electrolyzed water, the irrigation water, and you increase the oxidation reduction potential. This means that you increase the concentration of oxidative species compared with the untreated water. Here you can see the graph of the free chlorine through the 3 growing cycles, May, June, and July. As you can see here, the average of the free chlorine between the with the treated irrigation water was approximately 4 mg/L, then it was close to the concentration that we established at 5 mg/L. Okay, there were some variations, but more or less we were able to maintain close to the 5 mg/L than it was our objective. In this graph, I show you the content of chlorate in the in blue, in no chlorates in the untreated water, and some concentration of chlorates during May, June, and July. And you can see here that even the disinfection of irrigation water using electrolyzed water significantly increased the concentration of chlorates respect to the untreated water. The levels were very low, you can see here, the levels were very low and much lower than those permitted for potable water, that is 0.7 milligram per liter in tap water. So in all the cases, you can see here is approximately 0.1 milligram per liter. And here is the content of real methane, and as I told you, because in irrigation water, the content of organic matter is very low, they are not relevant. And you can see here, compared with the untreated water, you have some accumulation. Can you hear me, Grace? Grace?
Yes, Mabel, I can hear you. You can carry on.
Okay, thank you. So you can see here some accumulation of threonomethanes, but even there's some accumulation, the amount of threonomethanes detected were very low compared to the legal limits permitted for in drinking water. And as I told you in the table before, it was 1,000, so it was very low. That's why I tell you that this type of organic disinfection byproducts are not really relevant for irrigation water. They are relevant for processed wastewater because there are higher content of organic matter from the cat tissue in a fresh cat processing facility, and maybe they are more relevant there, but not in the irrigation water. Apart from that, these compounds are volatile, and as I told you, the main one that is chloroform are not really remain in the tissue. These two graphs show you the content of chlorates in one of the red lettuce cultivar variety and in the other one. And you can see here the content before processing, let's say at harvest, after processing, and also after storage. And you can see here in the first harvest, second harvest, and third harvest, for the same for the other type of red lettuce. And you can see there was a big increase from the first to the second and to the third, because there was some accumulation of chlorate in the substrate and also in the root, because they were the same plants, okay? But there was really a high increase, significant increase in the chlorate content after the storage of the third harvest. And this, it was because of the higher, let's say, the poor, the poorest quality of these baby lettuce at the third harvest. And there were more facility, more extractability of these chlorates. And I will talk about that point in my next presentation next Friday, and the reason why we obtain here a higher chlorate, okay? But the message is that, of course, there's some accumulation, and with the harvest, there's more accumulation, but even those, the levels remain quite low. You can see here that in the draft, the maximum residue levels are 0.15. approximately here. So this, don't consider this as a really true value. It's more of the chloride testing. We use a protocol that it was approved let's say in January they changed it, and now we have another protocol to avoid these changes in the extractability of chlorate from different quality of lettuce tissue. And this graph shows you the total threonomethanes before, and after processing and storage. You can see here there's no significant differences between those values at harvest or after processing and storage. And you can see that this disinfection, electrolyzed water, had a minor impact regarding the presence of trihalomethanes in baby lettuce. You see here, these are the values in irrigation water, and these are the values in fresh produce. And as I told you, there's no any regulation on fresh produce, but they are not important and relevant at all. So these are the conclusions. I'm going to read it. And the first are related to chlorates. Then, as you can see, the disinfection of irrigation water with a concentrated solution of electrolyzed water led to a significant increase in chlorate concentration. The presence of chlorates in irrigation water caused an accumulation of chlorates in the crop, reaching the levels above the current maximum residual levels of 0.01 milligram per kilogram. Is not with the new proposal, the new draft, that is 0.15 milligram per kilogram. This accumulation of chlorates in the substrate and also through the roots could explain the higher levels detected in the second and the third harvest compared with the first one. But in general, we show that the processing, particularly washing with the tap water and storage, did not affect the chlorate content, except the third harvest, but it was more on the protocol of extracting the plant material than really the explanation of why after 9 days of storage you increase the content of chlorates. Regarding the trihalomethanes, I can tell you that electrolyzed water did not impact the presence of trihalomethanes in irrigation water and in baby lettuce because the content remained very low. And so another conclusion is that we have to find the mitigation strategies that reduce the occurrence of this disinfection byproduct, particularly on the chlorates. And I wanted to add something else about the future trends. I think from my point of view, the use of electrolyzed water has a lot of potential, but we need to know why the formation of chlorates by electrolyzed water. And maybe there's some way to go to understand if we can reduce the formation of chlorates by the electrolysis, like, for instance, changing the material of the electrodes, the composition of these electrodes, the current, the pH and temperature, and also the store time. I can tell you that in this case, we generate the concentrated solution, and if you use it right away, you reduce the amount of chlorate. This is important, and it was related to some of your questions you asked Anna. For instance, the way you can reduce chlorate is one of the ways to go is to reduce the concentration of the solution you generate. As a more concentrated solution, more possibilities for the chlorate to be formed. This is an example that I wanted to share with you. These are our recent data about the different equipment you can use for generate electrolyzed water. In this graph on the left, you can see three different equipment, 25 liters per hour, 50 and 100 liters per hour. And you can see here the different free chlorine. And then if you want to generate, let's say, a free chlorine of 5 milligrams, you can have, in this case, with this equipment, a very low generation of chlorates compared with other equipment. So if you calculate, for instance, with these three equipment, the percentage of chlorate versus the free chlorine, you have a very different percentage. So it's very important for you to select the right equipment. It's not sometimes the more potent, not the higher current, not the current, or I cannot tell you. And but so it's a way, and I think it's a future trend to select the right equipment, at least for electrolyzed water and also for the chlorine dioxide in on site or already generated and stabilized solution. And that's for me today. Thank you very much for your attention.
All right. Thank you very much, Mabel. I have a question, but from a listener who's actually left. I will pose it anyway, just in case others have the same question. It says that you mentioned the levels of chlorate that are permitted in tap water. Do you think the EU intend on setting a lower permissible level for tap water to bring it in line with that of produce, if the issue here is human health?
I don't think so, because in fact the first source of chlorate is by tap water, and they try to maintain this free chlorine in all the system in order to make sure that during distribution of the tap water there's not any microbial contamination. So I expect they will maintain the level of chlorates in tap water, and they will reduce in other food products, particularly on fresh produce, you know, because now even it's a recommendation in order to reduce the amount of plastic, they are trying to promote that we need to drink tap water instead of water from bottles, you know.
All right. From our end here in the UK, we have a drinking water inspectorate, and sometimes we see summaries of what has been discussed, and it seems at one point that the member states the Commission were intending to reduce the level from 0.7 to 0.25, but we haven't really heard much since, because they were looking at chlorate separately to what you know, two different groups were looking at chlorate in water and another group looking at chlorate in produce, and they weren't really matching up. So we really are not sure, but we know that there have been proposals to reduce the amount of chlorate in drinking water to less than 0.7.
Yes, but let me I agree, and I agree that we need to reduce, because if it's the main source of chlorates, for instance, in our area, it's tremendous the people that are suffering from thyroid glands. You know, it's very, very high percentage of population that are suffering. And my man is just thinking that it's because of the tap water. It's not because of the fresh produce. But if they want to reduce, they have to find the technologies for treated tap water. We need to move from sodium hypochlorite. That is the reason why in our fields, you know what happened? They are using desalinization of the water from the sea, and the last treatment is with sodium hypochlorite. And sodium hypochlorite is the very first source of chlorates.
Thank you. I can't see any other questions from our listeners. If you've got any questions, please type them, because actually we've got 7 minutes. So we have time to answer any questions. Perhaps I'll wait for a minute, then if there isn't anything,
then I can also go through some of the questions. Let me know if you can hear me, Grace.
Yes, I can hear you now? Yes, I can.
Okay. So what happened is that some of the questions that Anna was answering, for instance, the light, the solar light, there were some questions about the presence of chlorates and the impact of solar light and the temperature. On the solutions of chlorine dioxide or electrolyzed water or any other disinfection solution based on chlorine, of course, there's an impact on solar light and also temperature, okay, and particularly store time. But on the plants, there's nothing to degrade the chlorates. The UV is not the same as a pesticide. There's not any degradation on the plant tissue, okay?
Yes.
I wanted to distinguish both than the on the chlorine dioxide or electrolyzed water and the plant tissue.
Thank you. We've got one more question here. When do you think the MRL for chlorates will be enforced?
I see. Probably you know more, Grace. So I think they stop asking the different countries for data. I think they've been collecting because from 2014 they started to ask the different countries to provide data to get these maximum residue levels. And from the January, this draft with the new proposition, I think it's going to be really on active shortly. What's your opinion, Grace? Probably you know more.
I think we are almost the same. There's a lot of uncertainty in terms of when they will impose the chlorate MRLs. From the responses, there's pushback from the different member states. So we have responses to their proposals from across a number of producer organizations and processors to say this is unachievable. So the Commission will have to look at these responses and any new data and formulate a way forward. But certainly from where we stand, we do not see that they will be enforcing these chlorate MRLs this year. But we will see where we are at the end of the year. We will know more. Okay. And we will now end this webinar. All the talks have been recorded for publicity post-broadcast. Like I said, I'm not sure how the first recording went because it wasn't working out from my end. But could I take this opportunity to highlight also the deadline for the three strategic smart water sites? If your business is interested in becoming a smart water site where you will get management consultancy services to become more labor efficient and leaner this season, please submit your application by the 14th of March 2019. Further details are available on the AHDB Smart Water website. So could I now please thank our speakers? They have done a good job. And thank you all for listening in. We hope we'll link up with you again next Friday, lunchtime. So have a good afternoon and goodbye.
Goodbye.